Patch 22 is finally here for Fallout 76, a brand new 30GB update that is a complete disaster for the game. Actually, no, just kidding. Even though this was expected to be received quite badly due to a large-scale nerf from Bethesda, it seems like they pulled out several last-minute changes to the patch as well as it ended up shipping with some surprise updates, and just overall, looking at the patch holistically, it is one of the best patches this game has ever seen and a resounding success from Bethesda. And again, this is in spite of the fact that a lot of people were expecting to hate this, including myself. But again, there are some last minute or surprise changes that we definitely have to go over, as well as some hidden changes that aren't even in the patch notes. If you guys enjoy the content, you can get subscribed or leave a like on this video. It does help the video with the overall YouTube algorithm. But otherwise, let's dive into Fallout 76's recent 30GB patch 22. So there are several new and large fundamental features added into the game, and I'm going to go through these one at a time and try and explain what exactly they bring to the table. And I think the first one to talk about is definitely One Wasteland, as it has the most far-reaching impact. One Wasteland is a comprehensive rebalance and scaling change to enemies and you and other players in Fallout 76. So right off the bat, when you see another enemy now, it is scaling to you, almost think of it as locally. So let's say you and your friend are playing, each of you might have that enemy show up as a different level and deal different amounts of damage to you and have different stats for you. So if I'm a level 10, the enemy will show up for level 10 for me, but if my friend's level 200, it might show up as a level 100 enemy for him. The idea behind this being that high levels and low levels can play together more frequently and more so across the board. There are some restrictions to this. Certain zones of the map and certain enemies will only scale down so far. In another sense, certain areas will only scale up so high. So even if you are level 1000, enemies will only go to level 50 in some areas. And across the board, enemies will only scale up to level 100 in general. As far as the actual impact One Wasteland has on the game, if you're a lower level player, it is kind of the same. I would say the big benefit is it's a lot more appropriate or just interesting to play with friends. If you have a high level friend, they won't just one-shot everything because the enemies are scaling differently for them. Previously, if an enemy showed up as level 10, it was level 10 for everyone on the server. But also, it seems like even in some of the far regions of Fallout 76, like Watoga, enemies are still fairly low level if you are low level. It's described how there are certain minimum zones, and at times, even as a level 14 character, I found enemies level 40, but I'm not sure if this is working appropriately, because you would think the Cranberry Bog, the highest level region, should have enemies higher level than 14. So there might be some issues as far as low level play with One Wasteland. But I think for higher level players, people over level 50 or 100, the impact is much more notable. Right off the bat, in some of those intro regions, instead of finding level 5 or 10 enemies, you'll consistently find level 50 enemies. It seems like now you will never encounter an enemy under level 50 outside of those small critters that are passive. So in like the forest region or some of the other intro regions, the enemies are a lot tougher now. You can't just clear through those easily because they are dealing appropriate amounts of damage for most players. But even further, in some of the higher level regions or during higher level events, you'll encounter level 75 or 100 enemies. And these guys deal more damage, they have more health, but also have better rewards. So they'll give more experience in general, although of course, weapons still only drop up to level 50. One of the interesting impacts of this is some events are now way harder. Doing things like Uranium Fever now has enemies spawning from level 50 to 75. Some of those past events that always had level 10 enemies will now at a minimum have level 50 enemies, so it'll be quite a bit tougher than it was previously. I would say overall this is a good change because again, you are getting more benefits, more experience from these enemies, and even further, the other big change, you will never get a weapon drop that is under level 50 now because all enemies are level 50. So all the items you get from, let's say, Uranium Fever won't be level 35 or 40, but will be 45 or 50 and usable, or at least optimal for most characters. But in general, at points, the game definitely feels harder. There's also the nerf, which we'll talk a bit about in a moment, but in particular, when doing certain events, you could get some tough enemies, and it definitely makes you pay more attention now. But overall, I'd say it's a really good addition to Fallout 76. The game definitely feels tougher at times, but again, with it being balanced out with better experience gain and the ability to play with earlier level players, it feels like this will be a really good addition to the game in the long term, and in some cases takes away that frustration of getting a subpar legendary. But then of course separately, we also do have daily ops, which functionally are rotating dungeons with a bit of a twist. So there are a few characteristics to daily ops that make them more than just a typical dungeon. Right off the bat, there's a new public team added with this update, a daily ops public team. You can complete complete daily ops with up to 4 other players, that including yourself. So 4 total at a time in your little instance dungeon. Each of these dungeons will have a game mode. Right now there's only one, that with uplink. After you begin, the clock will start and your role is to establish a couple of uplinks. You have to go to 2 locations in the dungeon, and the more players that stand in this location, the faster the uplink process will go. And this is actually important because I think people don't realize this. Sometimes it's better to just stand here and not actually fend off the enemies. All throughout there'll be enemies attacking you, dealing damage to you, but you could just kind of turtle up here and get the uplink to finish, because that is the objective, not killing all the enemies. There is an endless amount, and I think some people don't realize the point of this isn't to clear out all the enemies, but to establish the uplink. After that, there's a few more steps with taking down other enemies, and then a final boss enemy, which is pretty cool. It's actually a custom enemy depending on which enemy type you are facing. But with these dungeons, there's a couple of unique twists. Right at the bat, enemies you find here do have a unique effect in that they have higher perception, so sneaking just doesn't work. If you're a sneak build, it'll suck because that's not super relevant here. But even further, they do have 3 rotating factors about these dungeons. The location of the dungeon will change on a daily basis, the type of enemy you're facing will change on a daily basis, and then finally, the new aspect, what type of mutation the enemies have. So for day 1, it's taking place in the burrows, fighting robots with the resilient mutation. But 24 hours after this one goes live, so at noon or 1 PM tomorrow, that being Eastern time, the location, mutation, and enemy type will switch. So you might be in Vault 94 with super mutants that are cloaking until they attack you. I'm not going to go through all the mutations or locations here because I feel like it's kind of fun to experience them. Right now there are 3 enemy types with robots, super mutants, and blood eagles. And the real goal of this is to actually complete the uplink quest as quickly as possible. Once you actually complete this, you'll find a new custom UI element wherein the faster you go, the better rewards you'll get. And it's actually really well implemented, so most of this is self-explanatory. There's no time limit in a sense that you could take an hour doing this if you want. It won't ever kick you out, but you won't get the better rewards if you take an hour. And even further, as you can see for these 3 ranks, you can only complete 1 per rank per day. So you have to get 1 sub-8-minute run-in per day to get the good or unique rewards from this dungeon. Although the rewards of this one are pretty cool. There's a full spreadsheet I'll have linked in the description, but these have a chance at rewarding treasury notes, script caps. It'll consistently drop legendary items, but the higher tier rank you complete it at, you'll actually have a chance at earning 2 legendary items, 1 to 3 stars. And actually, just an even better aside, the UI displaying everything you earned is great, but it also deposits these items directly into your inventory. No longer do you have the frustration of trying to find that big enemy you just took down or claiming your rewards in some kind of box somewhere. It's a really good change from Bethesda, sometimes viewed as a relatively minor one, but I think a very positive one. Hopefully something we see more of going forward. This awards contextual ammo in 2 ways. Firstly, as you kill enemies in the dungeon, they'll actually drop the ammo type you kill them with. So if using a shotgun, it'll drop shotgun shells. This is really handy and a great way to just get a ton of ammo. But also after completing this, it'll award you ammo also of whatever weapon you complete it with. So whatever weapon you're holding as the dungeon comes to a conclusion. If you're using melee, it's just random. But then a variety of unique rewards, and these are pretty cool. I'm gonna have a link to the full spreadsheet in the description down below, not only including the unique rewards, but just all of the rewards and chances of earning them. There are 2 major tiers for these unique rewards, uncommon ones and then rare items. You have a chance at earning these at every rank, but you have the highest chance, and actually highest chance by quite a bit, for the elder rank. And again, you only have 1 shot per day at earning the unique rewards. There's some miscellaneous camp items, some of these old ones that are now repurposed for this, but nothing super crazy or super influential. Where things get a lot more interesting are on the rare items, and actually several camp items included here also. You have the scavenged solar panel, which is just a new power item, but looks pretty cool. The symptomatic, which is unique in that it actually cures disease in Fallout 76, and you can place this at your camp, so you can have a repeatable method at curing your disease, not a disease cure. A super reactor, which is more or less just a souped up reactor you could place at your camp. A recipe for liquid courage. This is going to give you +1 luck and +1 strength, but also immunity to fear attacks, such as those from the Wendigo Colossus, which can be pretty handy. The Warglaive, which is a new Brotherhood of Steel themed weapon from this. You earn the base Warglaive from this event, which is not tradable, unfortunately, but then you can unlock mods via the gold bullion system, which are actually pretty unique and cool. You get the plan for the gutter and the whistle in the dark from this. Each of these are unique weapons that were added from previous Fallout 76 DLCs or methods, but now you could actually get the plan and in turn different legendary drops on them. And then finally, the very cool looking Brotherhood Spec Ops suit and mask, each being a separate drop. So unfortunately, if you want both, you'll probably do a lot of grinding and they are going to be very valuable. Overall, Daily Ops is an interesting one right now in that it is probably one of my favorite new feature additions for Fallout 76. One of the coolest new things Bethesda has added. I love the way it's added right now. I think the mutations as well as the change up each day keeps it fresh and exciting, and the rewards are very good. It's gonna probably take quite a bit of grinding to finally get them, but the grind is enjoyable. I find Daily Ops overall just a lot of fun, and there's a ton of potential with these in the future. Add in new locations, add in new mutations, and even new enemy types. They have great framework right now to keep this aspect of the game interesting, or even just add in new rewards, which they already said they plan on doing. Except, right now, the current mix that's live in the game, because again, this resets once every 24 hours, is probably the worst combination, both in the sense that it is the most difficult and also the most frustrating. You have robots on the burrows that are resilient, aka requiring a melee attack to kill them. So if you try Daily Ops today and you're like, this is horrible, why do people like this? Try again tomorrow. I guarantee it'll almost certainly be better than it is today. The resilient mutation is without a doubt the most difficult to deal with out of the bunch. Some of the other ones just slow you or have invisible enemies, but you don't have to melee them, which of course requiring a melee attack to finish off an enemy is kind of a huge issue for a lot of people who use ranged weapons or don't want to get close to enemies that can kill you with one hit on a bloodied build. Unfortunately, there are a few issues with Daily Ops, nothing super game breaking, but frustrating. Definitely seems like there were some hit detection issues due to lag or server load. At points, depending on the server, and this is of course a bigger issue with the resilient mutation, my melee swings were just not registering, whether it be in VATS or even outside of VATS. There's some issues with joining Daily Ops teams. Either there would be a slot open or visually a slot open, but it would give me an error. I tried this numerous times on several servers, or even other times it just wouldn't do anything as I tried to join the team. The weekly challenge for this seemed to be bugged out where it would complete even if you didn't do all the criteria, didn't complete three Daily Ops, but I had the challenge completed. But overall, it's still a good feature. Just wanted to mention that it is a little bit on the buggy side in the live version. But then separately, we also do have legendary perks, which is probably one of the features we've known about the longest that finally got an addition to Fallout 76. It's actually pretty simple. You'll have up to 6 legendary perk slots depending on your character's level. There's no cost associated with this. Just rank up your character, and the higher the rank, the more slots you'll have open. They lock at certain milestones. And then from there, you'll have access immediately to all of the legendary perks, and you can just choose which ones you want to fill out those slots with. There's a variety here, one for each special stat, so it'll add in additional points to each special stat. You get whatever bonuses that provide to your character, but also more perk card slots. Although this won't allow you to bypass the 15 point perk card cap. So if you already have all 15 perk card points, it's not going to give you more slots for perk cards. And actually, in a disclaimer here, the charisma one doesn't allow you to share additional perk cards, but then several other ones. I'm not going to dive too deeply into what each of these do, as again, you could just view them for yourself in game. It'd probably take a good 5 minutes to go over the pros and cons of each, but there's some solid ones, bonuses for armors or weapons, having lockpicking and hacking be just a legendary perk card slot, not regular perk card slots, which is a long requested feature. But there's also some more controversial or tedious aspects to this, and that comes with ranking these up and getting perk card coins, a new currency in Fallout 76. So although you can assign each legendary perk card for free, if you actually want to upgrade it or de-equip it, it will cost a perk coin. So if you want to remove it, it's 1 perk card coin, but then if you want to upgrade it, it's 50 coins, 100 coins, and then 150 coins. The way you get perk card coins is the regular perk cards, and you get 2 coins per rank. So if it's a rank 1, you get 2 coins. If it's a rank 3, you get 6 coins, etc. And this definitely is pretty costly. If you want to rank up all of your legendary perk card slots to max level, it'll take thousands of levels. I'm sure most of us will not be able to do that, so we have to think a little bit strategically about which perk cards we actually want to rank up, and then of course having some in our back pocket to swap these around. Even further, one of the more frustrating parts is it is really annoying to scrap all of those levels, so you'll just be kind of sitting here spamming a key to unlock a bunch of perk cards to eventually scrap them and transition them into coins. It would have been nice if Bethesda could have just been like, oh, you have 20 level ups unlocked on your character, you could just convert those into coins naturally really not go through this whole process, but I guess the tech wasn't there yet. Overall, it's one of those grinds that I definitely wouldn't attempt directly. I would just kind of keep it in the background, level things up as you go. Some of the legendary perks are definitely pretty strong. Some are a bit underwhelming. I'd really categorize most of them as being pretty handy, but none are really game changing or going to totally transform builds, at least based on my first impressions. I wasn't doing 5 times more damage as a result of any of these perk cards yet. Although one thing that is very handy is these perk card slots are actually account wide. So once you unlock them all on one character, you can go to a totally new or low level character and actually assign legendary perk cards also. The leveling up process seems to be unique to each character, so level ups won't carry over, but the slots themselves and level 1 perk cards will, which is very handy. Overall, another solid addition. Again, I think it didn't necessarily live up to the hype for some players, but I don't think it has any major flaws either. It's a decent one that I'm happy to finally see get added. Then that transitions us into Season 2. The next season for Fallout 76's Battle Pass went live with this update, and it also featured some fundamental changes to the Battle Pass. Right off the bat, if you're not familiar with the season system, more or less, there are daily and weekly challenges in Fallout 76 that do reset on a daily and weekly basis. These award you points that do contribute towards your rank on the overall season. Each rank in the season gives you some kind of reward. Could be armor, could be a weapon, could be a camp item, or some other less tangible things. Perk card packs, which are now handy with the legendary perk system, caps, gold bullion, etc. Some of the notable rewards from this that are pretty interesting: there's a greenhouse, a couple of cool armors towards the end of this one to work towards. Some have a light Brotherhood of Steel theme. There's actually some camp items with a very direct Brotherhood of Steel theme and inspired from past games Brotherhood of Steel. Grass plots that you could place in your camp so you could actually grow things inside, which is a huge new feature added with this. And also this very handy weight bench that you could get fairly early on, which gives you +2 strength for 30 minutes. Which +2 strength for 30 minutes in general, very handy, but it's actually broken right now, or at least seemingly broken in that you could stack this to an unlimited degree. This is likely going to get hotfixed, so depending on when you watch this, it might not work anymore, but you could just keep reusing this weight bench over and over again and get unlimited strength on your character to be very, very strong and get some ridiculous damage numbers. So overall, some decent new rewards. It's really going to be your preference. Do you want to grind for this? Do you not want to grind for this? But there's also some changes added to the season system, making the grind a bit easier. Right off the bat, you can purchase rank ups from day one now. So if you don't want to grind at all, you could just pay 150 atoms to skip some ranks. There's also additional daily and weeklies. There's going to be a daily ops, weekly, and daily challenge now. And this is additive. So in the past, there were 7 daily challenges, 7 weekly challenges. But now there's actually 8 daily challenges, adding in that new daily ops one on top, and 10 weekly challenges. This gives you quite a bit more flexibility. So if you don't play Fallout 76 every day, just once a week or a couple times a week, there'll be more challenges for you to complete overall. It's actually a good change from Bethesda, giving more player autonomy here. Some of the rewards from the previous season are now gold bullion rewards in game. So now if you have gold bullion, you can get lunchboxes, some of the fertilizer creators, the ammo converter. So they're not gone forever after the season ended. They're just implemented in a bit of a more expensive and different way. So overall, the season's pretty similar. Again, some additional player autonomy with the addition of some more challenges. You could rank up faster now, and the challenges themselves are pretty similar. I think the season system or battle pass overall is a great addition for Fallout 76. I know it's had some controversial moments. It definitely needed some more quality assurance in the first season rewards. There's a lot that had issues, but in general, it seems like it gets players playing more frequently. And for me, I don't really pay a ton of attention to it. I'm not logging on every day to specifically do these grinds. I don't mind missing out on some things, but for those who do, it is a free way to get some cosmetics and people like working towards something. So I think it has some pros in that regard. But then let's move on to the big damage recalculation that went live with patch 22 for Fallout 76. And for many, we expected this to be a big controversy. As large in part, what you could find is as a result of this damage recalculation, we got a giant nerf to damage output in Fallout 76. Except not really. So basically the way this all worked was, a little over a month ago, this change went live on the public test server. Bethesda described how damage calculation, so when you have your base weapon damage, then legendary effects, perk cards, different chems you might be using, the way all of that calculates together to reach a final damage number will switch from being multiplicative to additive. So previously it would multiply to reach the final number, now it would add and then multiply to reach the final number. Which did mean that there was actually going to be a large reduction in how much damage was being done. And you can see this even in some of the numbers. Comparing live versions of the game to the PTS, at points you were getting a quarter damage or a half damage of what you were doing previously. Except, as this just went live with patch 22, Bethesda actually changed the calculation. It's not totally clear what happened, but damage is higher. So it still is recalculating in a different way, but overall, if you compare damage output on the final days of the public test server to the now live version of the game, damage is less in the live version than it was previously, but it's still higher than it was on the public test server. This is a complete surprise. It's almost a double-edged sword in that, hey, why wasn't this communicated by Bethesda? Why wasn't this tested on the public test server? But also kind of no harm, no foul. It large in part is a good thing. The nerf is much smaller than previously anticipated. It still is a definite nerf. You could see on some of my weapons that just comparing to the past version of the game to now with this update, damage is much less, but still significantly higher than what it was on the PTS. So that is definitely a good thing. To go along with this update, Bethesda had a few notes on it. They described, well, stacking damage bonuses will now have a smaller overall effect on your damage output than before. These changes will make the resulting damage much more predictable and allow for future improvements. It is very important for the health of the game going forward. It will also create better opportunities for us to make smarter and more effective balance changes. And going on to say, we're still evaluating feedback we gathered on these changes from the PTS, but we also welcome your thoughts on how different weapons and builds feel after today's update so that we can make additional adjustments in the future. And this large in part is a restatement of some of the stuff we saw on the public test server and Bethesda's response to that initial feedback. It still definitely feels misleading because it still is a big nerf to the game, even though Bethesda literally said it's not intended to be a nerf, but it is a nerf. They also described how there'll be future buffs or it allows for them to buff things in the future, but we've heard nothing about what actually that will be, and none of those have been implemented thus far. And considering it's Bethesda, I wouldn't be shocked if there's maybe a few minor buffs going on in the future, but nothing as substantial as this nerf. But overall in game, you'll definitely notice it from time to time, in particular when you are fighting higher health enemies or high level enemies. This is kind of skewed because we also have, in general, higher level enemies because of one wasteland, so it's almost hard to tell how impactful this is, but in general, your damage output will likely be a bit lower. As far as the meta change, things are large in part the same, so the top builds are still the top builds. It actually seems like two-shot explosive is somewhat making a comeback with this, but otherwise whatever you're using before is still probably good, it just might have overall a bit less damage output, but everything has slightly less damage output. But I would say for a lot of players, you might not even notice a huge difference just because of how much damage you were doing to begin with. You kill enemies so fast in this game with top tier builds that killing them slightly slower isn't actually all that noticeable. And again, really only comes out when fighting more boss tier enemies by yourself. Unfortunately, some of the magic weapons or hacked in weapons weren't overhauled or changed with this, such as being removed or fixed, so some of the magic energy weapons or magic shotguns are still pretty broken. Even further, there technically were a few other buffs or changes to damage overall. The alien blaster got a flat buff, which is handy and helpful, but energy weapons overall are still kind of bad, and I don't think this makes it a super top tier choice, but at least it's a bit more considerable now. Assassins was reworked. This previously did 10% bonus damage to other players that has been reworked to now other humans like it was in Fallout 4. Unfortunately, it's still only 10% damage bonus to other humans. In Fallout 4, this was actually 50%, and I think that's what they should have added with Fallout 76. They also shifted the shish kebab from doing energy to fire damage, so that is a slight buff for that weapon also. Overall though, with this one, I think right now in game, it's not a huge issue. You can still enjoy the game. It's not like you're doing so much less damage that the fun factor is totally removed. And again, some of you will probably not even notice. And technically what Bethesda says here is true. It is making future damage changes or calculations a lot easier. Damage output is a lot more predictable with this change to additive multipliers. But at the same time, it's Bethesda with Fallout 76, and following through or staying consistent with updates or patching certain features has been an issue for them in the past. So I personally have serious concerns that these buffs they're talking about will be sizable or consistent and a thing they regularly do. I for one would love to see more balance changes to Fallout 76, overbuff a ton of legendary effects, and then subsequent patches nerf them to try and change up the meta. Give me more options as far as top tier choices. Like with assassins, make it do plus 50% damage against humans. That'd be a cool way to change things up or mix it up. But at the very least, this didn't end up being a giant disaster like many of us expected it to, so that was a great thing to find in the 11th hour. A few other minor changes with perk cards. Modern Renegade now has increased chance to cripple limbs at different ranks. The tank killer perk card now benefits pistols also. Other although it seems like the rank 3 of this perk card is bugged, so it'll still give you a benefit but won't actually scale as much as it says in the perk card, although ranks 1 and 2 are fine. Some other changes: there's now free fast travel to Crater and Foundation. Another huge surprise change, not actually in the patch notes, combat rifle skins can now be applied to the Fixer. The Fixer is one of the top tier weapons in Fallout 76, a staple of many builds, so this is actually really handy for a lot of players. We can now find light and ultralight limb mods for the Secret Service armor from Regs for gold bullion. Vault 94 is reopened. It's now a fully explorable interior. It again was repurposed as a dungeon for daily ops. And functionally, there's not much new in the vault, but it's just something you could actually go do, explore, read the lore. Also, the Treehouse Village has been reworked. This is going to be connected to some quest lines coming down the line, but you could find it changed in game right now. With this, there was also a variety of bug fixes for Fallout 76. Some of these actually pretty impactful, but some of them kind of frustrating. Several camp exploits, or they're technically exploits, but really were used as tricks for camp builders, were patched. So again, like we saw a couple of updates ago, camp builders now have slightly less tools in their arsenal. It's one of these weird things where technically it is using an exploit, but at the same time, it's not really harming many people, and it can be handy for the camp builders, which is a huge part of Fallout 76. There are a few reports that some people noticed their camp budget was smaller following this update, but it's kind of hard to verify that, and again, there's only a few reports of it overall. The Scorch Beast Queen finally got the ability to be crippled again, and it's actually a bit of a change. You can now cripple the wings or her legs. If you cripple her wings, it'll cause her to land, and if you cripple her legs, it'll lower her rotation speed, so the speed at which she could turn around and attack things. The Ounce of Prevention quest is finally fixed, this being one of the core quests you needed to complete Wastelanders with. It was broken for a very long time. They fixed an issue which could make the quick heal hotkey not work while switching game mode, so it seems like this is fixed for Nuclear Winter, although many of the other Nuclear Winter hotkeys and Hot Wheel is still broken. So initially, as you join that mode, many times you can't use hotkeys for switching weapons, although at least now you could heal yourself. The Fort Defiance exploit, we could have all the ghouls spawn in the middle, was patched, so you can no longer do that. It seems like they somewhat fixed the respawn bug, this being when you die during an event, but then it forces you to actually choose a spot to respawn, even though you're supposed to just respawn automatically. This is very frustrating. It doesn't seem like it's totally fixed, but they mention how it should reduce the number of times this pops up now. Some of the issues with Class Freak interacting with certain mutations were fixed. Some clipping issues on the Screaming Eagle skin, which has just had a lot of problems, are also fixed. Not being able to fast travel to other players' camps if you had the Future Tech camp skin equipped has been fixed again. Objects floating in the Communist Bunker has been fixed. It seems like you have to replace these. They also changed up the interior walls of the Communist Bunker, so now they're hexagonal, making it easier to place things on them, no longer being circular. As well as the Communist Fence now has an alternate version that can be freely placed without needing to snap to other objects. So if you bought these items in the past, they are now a lot more usable. Previously, they had some weird quirks or kind of features to them that made it a little bit more frustrating. They actually fixed an exploit where you could place ammo factories at your camp, and this is a big one in that it's actually voiding entire camps. In the past, there was basically a way to place down the ammo factory that you could place down at one of the workshops in Fallout 76 at your camp, and sometimes many of them at your camp, and you could just produce ammo freely at your camp. But basically what Bethesda did was made it so if you had these at your camp, you can now no longer place that camp down, including stored versions of it. So if you have a schematic that includes an ammo factory, it is no longer applicable. So that's a big blow to people that were abusing this exploit. You might have to start rebuilding your camp from the ground up now. And then finally, the firework quick reload glitch was patched out. So overall with this one, it's a pretty interesting patch for Fallout 76, and that I would say it's one of the best, but it's one of the best for kind of bad or the wrong reasons in a way, in that it's a solid patch. Everything it adds in is working mostly fine. It adds in a ton of great new features into Fallout 76, and after it went live, I tested a lot of the stuff on live servers. I was really happy. There were again some surprises, the nerf not being as large as it's supposed to be, being able to apply skins to the Fixer, although both of those are kind of weird in that they weren't communicated, so although they're pleasant surprises, I feel like just good communication would be better. But also, I find myself being so happy or impressed with this patch, mostly because it doesn't do anything wrong. Like, yes, it does a ton of good stuff. I think daily ops in particular are a great addition to this game, going to be one of my favorite features going forward. And One Wasteland and Legendary Perks are two great things to have there in the background to always be attending to, and are improving the game in big ways. But the difference between this patch and several of the past ones over the past few months is it didn't screw anything up. It is technically a step forward for Bethesda, but it's them kind of getting to where you would hope they always were. It's not like they're doing a really super extra good job now. It's just like, okay, this is an acceptable patch. There are a few minor bugs here or there, but nothing super major. Feels like this one was actually tested and a lot of bug fixes went live with it. There still are a lot of other bug fixes needed for this game, lingering issues that have yet to be addressed, but this patch at the very least did knock out a few of those. Things like the Scorched Beast Queen and Ounce of Prevention finally being fixed. So overall, it's one of those weird situations. Do you praise Bethesda for doing what they should have always been doing? Like, on one hand, yes, the new content is awesome. I'm having a ton of fun with it. I was having a ton of fun with it on the public test server. Now to see it go live relatively hiccup-free is great. And this is definitely the quality of patch I hope we see more of in the future. Hopefully this marks some kind of internal change, but do you praise that? It's not like they necessarily went above and beyond again. It's just that there wasn't any major screw-ups this time. So is that something you cheer them on for? I guess, kind of. Either way, at the very least, if you take a break from Fallout 76 after the season ended, or even just over the past couple of months, it's a really good time to give it another try. I don't know if this patch is necessarily worth buying the game for like Wastelanders, but it's probably the best patch this game has seen since the Wastelanders update, which is saying a lot. It's probably one of the best patches the game's received overall, and adds in a ton of new content in a relatively bug-free way, which hopefully is something we can continue to expect in the future. Either way though, those are my thoughts on this one. I'd love to hear from all of you guys in the comments down below. Are you enjoying this patch? What do you think about the integration or implementation of some of its features? But until next time, I thank you all for watching again, and I hope to see you all later.